It all starts with an idea,
Right.
and ideas come from everywhere. Sometimes we have ideas that come from our users. People always mailed us and said, how come I can't search my computer as fast as I can search the web? That causes us to do a Google desktop.
Right.
There are some that come from our engineers. Google News and Orkut came from the engineers. There are some that come from the executives. Larry really wanted to do Gmail. He really thought mail could be much improved.
Right.
And there's some that come from a real strategic analysis. Finance and maps, we said, you know, we're seeing our users go to the competition and use a product that we don't think is very good and that we think we can improve on, and we really think we should round out our offering. So ideas come from everywhere, and it starts with that idea, and then it's about building a prototype. Can you build something that really illustrates what technology you're going to use? How are you going to create an innovation out of that? How are you going to capture the imagination and the attention of the users and really meet their needs? And so taking that prototype then and building out a team around it and really productionizing it, and then it becomes the sort of the fun part of the fit and finish of the details. How does it look? How does it work? You know, is each pixel just right, just so, right? It's like almost like producing a movie. You want to make sure that that product walks out the door the way that you want it. And also not doing that too much, right? Because a big part of our innovation process is iteration. Try something, get a lot of feedback, try something new. And so really bird walking along that path to what the user really wants, which means launching early and launching often.
I mean, Google clearly has done well because it had a very good idea, and it executed a very good idea very well. Beyond that, why has Google been as successful as it has?
Well, I think there's a lot of different elements of the culture that have really fostered innovation. We like to work with really small teams. When I started, there were about 9 engineers, and Larry and Sergey said, well, we have 9 engineers, and right now they do about 3 different things.
Yeah.
So if we double and we have 18 engineers, would we want them to do the 3 things twice as well, or would we want to do twice as many things? And I said, well, obviously we'd want to do twice as many things.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's how we've grown. We've tried to keep the teams really small, which leads to a sense of empowerment, people making decisions around what's the best feature, what do their users need, how are they going to build the best product, and it allows also for them to be really agile. You know, we try and avoid meetings, and like a lot of reasons when you have one of the great things that happens with a small team is you can put them all in the same office. At Google, we usually have 3 or 4 people in each office, and that works really well because when they want to make a decision, people just roll back from their desk and say,
hey,
I've got something that we need to decide right now. And so that allows the teams to really be very agile. And we've also had a really broad mission all along. Larry and Sergey had the foresight to give the company the mission of organizing the world's information.
Right.
And making it useful and
accessible.
And
how far along are we on that?
We've just barely gotten started. And so, but with that broad mission, you know, every Googler has an idea. Googlers are what we call the Google employees. Every Googler has an idea as to something that's not being done right now that could be done.
Most of the ideas come in from in-house?
They come from all over. As I said, sometimes we get ideas from our users and from observations.
But most of them?
Most of them, I would say, come in-house. So especially when you're a leader in search, you really do need to be looking at both the user needs and also where's the technology going to take us, what's possible and what's not, right? So, for example, we'd like to make progress on both vision and voice.
Yes.
Can we recognize what's in an image? How well can we recognize
a spoken word?
And I think voice is actually a lot further along than images in recognizing shapes in them. If you look at the academic research, that's generally the case. But so sometimes you have to follow the technology, what's possible. I think we're going to have really good voice search, really good speech to text on YouTube videos,
right.
So you'll be able to search it. That will happen sooner than you'll be able to, say, give Google an image and say, find other images like this, or find me images of a monkey, those types of things.
Join us online at charlierose.com.